Howdy gang, Jeff McAleer once again, and today I am reviewing the Dresden Files Cooperative Card Game, designed by Eric B. Vogel and released by Evil Hat Productions. This is a cooperative card game, thus the title, for 1 to 5 players ages 13 and up, and each story takes about 30 minutes for you to complete. And of course, obviously enough, the game is set in Jim Butcher's universe of the Dresden Files. So let's head on over to the gaming table and find out how do you play the Dresden Files.
Okay, so I've laid out the game for 3 players. You can play anywhere from 2 to 5. Personally, I find the sweet spot for the Dresden Files cooperative card game is 3 players. There is a 2-player variant that's included in the game, and I'll discuss that a little bit later. I don't think it's too hot, but the premise of the game is removing these cards from these 2 rows. So these are the challenges that the players are going to face. And they break down into foes, cases, advantages, and obstacles. And they're color-coded. Green is an investigation, red is a foe, purple is an advantage, and yellow is an obstacle. And those colors also coordinate with the cards in the player's decks. Now, when I did my unboxing video, I wasn't too sure what these cards actually were, and they're actually dividers. They're divider cards because if we take a look at the box here, you actually get the first 5 novels of the Dresden Files as cases, or chapters, I guess we would say. There's also side jobs, which you can kind of create a randomized game from different stories in the short story collection, side jobs. And then we also have more of these separators or dividers for the expansions that are coming out. So you have those already for the other decks of characters as well as the chapters. What I've laid out here is for Stormfront. And each of the players is going to have a character deck. So in the core game, you have Harry Dresden, Karen Murphy, Susan Rodriguez, Billy and Georgia, the werewolves, as well as Michael Carpenter. For this chapter, or tale, I've selected Harry Dresden, Karen Murphy, and Susan Rodriguez. And the reason why is if you look at these cards, they're not just simply separators. They also tell you a little bit about the adventure as well as each of the characters. So if we look here, each of the stories is made up of 12 cards. So we see there's 4 foes, 4 cases, 2 obstacles, 2 advantages. If we take a look at the separator, it shows Harry's attack 3, investigate 3, overcome 2, take advantage 2. That's the number of cards. And then by these little stars, they tell you just how good is Harry at those particular, I guess we would say, aspects of the game. We see Susan, 3, 3, 2, 2, and her investigative skills are excellent. Attack, not so great. Karen Murphy, once again, excellent investigation. Her attack strength is pretty good. Well, she is a police officer after all. But she only has the 2 attack cards. So it's important when you're looking at the different stories that you're going to play to see what you're going to go up against when you select your characters. Because the way the game is set up is you're going to have a deck of cards for your character. And if you don't have cards that play to that character's strength, you're going to have a problem. Especially if you've chosen a character whose strength really isn't reflected in the cards that you're going to eliminate from the board. To give you an idea, I'm already dealt out a 7-card deck for Harry, because with 3 players, each player would get 7 cards. And each character also has a talent and a stunt. Now, the stunt is kind of a one-shot. You get to do it once during the game, and then you would flip it over, and for the rest of the game, it shows that it's been used. So Harry is able to flip this card over to use his blasting rod and to add 4 hits to any one foe that could be defeated by 1 to 4 hits. And I'll discuss that in a moment. His talent is when you discard a card for fate points, you may move 1 obstacle or advantage card forward or backward 1 space in either row. Taking a look at the cards themselves, the breakdown, it'll tell you what it is, and of course, this is color-coded, so seeing it's purple, and even by the icon here, for those who may have color blindness, it's going to be able to help you to determine right away this is an advantage. It's going to show what is the cost. So the cost is going to be 2 fate, plus you're going to roll a fate die, because the game includes 8 fate dice. And if you're not familiar with fate dice, they're utilized in the Fate role-playing game and the various titles under Fate. Say my favorite Atomic Robo role-playing game, which is awesome. Anyway, you'll see that these dice have a positive and a negative. So you've got 2 positives, 2 negatives, 2 blank. So let's say this card would get played. Somebody would roll a fate die, and it might cost 2 if they get that blank. It might cost 3 if they get that plus, or it may cost 1. Of course, you have to actually have fate points to be able to cast these spells. And I'll get into, or utilize the card, the ability of that character. Let me put those dice back down. You'll also see that each of the cards shows a range. And if we look at the board here, we see the various cards. Range 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this card could be played only in these first 2 spots. You can only target these first 2 spots with this card. We've got an infinite range for consulting with Bob. Cost 4 fate, and you get 2 clues to all cases in 1 row. Soul Gaze, the Blue Beetle. And of course, down here, if you see a star, it's going to have some variable effect. It's going to have some special effect, the Pyrofuego attack. I have to point out, people are going to be thrown a little bit to realize that each of the characters have 10 cards. That's it. That's all they have. And depending on how many players you have in your game will determine how many cards you get. So if you're playing 3 players, you would get 7. If you're playing with 4 players, you get 5. And if you play with 5 players, you only get 4. And there's a lot of randomness to this design. And I have to point out, a lot of it I don't care for, and I will explain. So, the point of the game is when the game comes to an end, and there are different ways to trigger the end, you need to have actually solved more cases, so you need to have removed more green cards from the board than foes which remain on the board, the red. And I'll show you, for an example, a foe. So the Toad Demon takes 8 hits, but there's also a special down here that you can't damage this toad until Who is the Shadow Man is solved. And you'll also notice some of the cards will have a circle with either an inward-facing arrow or an outward-facing arrow that indicates that there's some connection between the 2 cards. So we already know you can't receive hits. The Toad Demon can't receive hits until Who is the Shadow Man is solved. And if we take a look at Who is the Shadow Man, we see there's the B pointing outward. And it takes 10 clues to be able to solve this. And it mentions can't add hits to the Toad Demon until you solve the card. Pretty easy there. There's also an inward pointing C, whereas Victor is missing. When solved, add 3 clues to Who is the Shadow Man. So you really have to pay attention to the text on these cards, because a lot of the cards are going to be interconnected. The advantages are actually good, so you want to try to be able to grab advantages whenever you can and utilize them at the most appropriate time. So for an example, Speed Potion, the one taken, the active player draws one card, then immediately takes another turn. And you get to move that big bad Toad Demon to the furthest remaining range. And that's one of the things I actually do dig about the game, is there is a major puzzle aspect to the design. You're not just sitting there playing your cards all the time and doing different things and just moving right through it. You have to stop, and you have to pause, and you have to think about how you're approaching the game. I will mention that the rules say, even though it's a cooperative game, that the players shouldn't discuss in detail the cards that they have available to them. You can tell the other players, well, I've got an attack card, or I've got some attack cards, or I've got a take advantage card, but you can't show other players your cards or discuss the effects and kind of game plan how you approach the game. Personally, I found that kind of silly. It's a cooperative card game. In fact, one option is no discussion whatsoever while you're playing it, when you become experienced with the game. I found that really silly because it's a cooperative game. I mean, part of the point of playing a cooperative game is that you're going to discuss what you're doing. Otherwise, you might as well just play a game in a vacuum. So, I already pointed out that the main gist of the game is to solve more cases than have foes remaining on the board. Basically, it breaks down to if you have more foes or equal foes to the number of cases, you lose. So really, all you're looking to do is solve these cases. But as you can see, you're randomly placing these cards. This could be fairly tough. In order to use your abilities, you have to spend fate. And we have Harry's 7 cards here. Well, you know what? Let's look at Susan Rodriguez. Her stunt is flip the card over to choose any one player to draw a card, and then they take the next turn. And her talent is when she discards a card for fate points, she gets to add 1 clue to a case at the shortest range. So Susan has expose, a nose for news, play a hunch. So let's say Susan happens to be the first player. Well, she has exposés a range of 3. She could tackle either Ritual Double Murder, which actually starts off the Stormfront book, or try to tackle Victor is Missing. Let's say, as an example, let's do play a hunch, which would cost 4 fate, which are these tokens down here. These little red blasts are hits, and these little green skulls are clues. So we would spend 4 fate, and it would allow us to place 4 clues at a range of 1. So we would take the 4 clues, and we're going to place them on the Ritual Double Murder. Susan would then, the player representing Susan, would then discard this card. That card's gone. There's no reshuffling, there's no draws from the deck. outside of a special effect of one of the cards that gets played, or possibly one of the advantages. In four-player games, it's very possible for you not to have cards, as I mentioned before, that play up to the strength of your character. It would be conceivable in a five-player game that Susan Rodriguez's hand of cards is this. Well, these are her two weakest abilities. And it leads to a lot of frustration with the players. We have played this quite a few times, and I will be the first to admit that quite a few of the players did get a little bent out of shape when you have your hand of cards don't play to the strength of your character. There is an optional rule. There are a lot of optional rules in this very short rule book, which makes me feel that this design is very undercooked, which allow you to choose a type of card, and when you deal your hand, if you don't have that type of card in your hand, then you can reshuffle and redeal. For myself, that's just more busy work and kind of a waste of time. But if you don't, well, you're going to have a very difficult time actually not only winning a game, but feeling like you're competing in the game. So, as an example, we're going to say that Susan played a hunch. And then let's say it would be Harry's turn. So Harry's taking a look to see what he's got. Well, let's see. Harry could play five fate and play soul gaze and add five plus possibly two more clues to the ritual double murder, which would eliminate that card. So let's say Harry decides that's the card he's going to play. And just for the sake of argument, lo and behold, those two dice get the positive sides. So that would be seven. We would remove these clues. And hooray! The case is solved! And it would go into our solved cases. I will want to point out there are tokens that I've left in the box which show five hits or five clues. So if you need to make change, that's fine. So when you remove a card, when you've defeated a foe or solved a case or overcome an obstacle or taken an advantage, these cards now move. They shift down, and we've seen this sort of mechanic in many cooperative deck building games. Upper Deck's Legendary series of games comes immediately to mind when you're moving the cards. And it's important that you start getting these cards to start moving closer in, because it's very possible that something you really need to be able to solve or do has to be close, that you may not have the range available to tackle the cards. So each turn, I should mention, players are able to do one of a few things. So what was that? That was five, right? Okay, let's get rid of five. Susan's card was five? Nope, it was four. So we've got four fate points left. So a player can spend fate points to use an ability to basically play a card. They can choose to pass by spending one fate point. They can also use their stunt. So you can flip that over, play that stunt. Remember, it's only a one-time use. Or they can discard a card, and let's take a look at Karen Murphy for an example. So Karen's talent is when this person discards a card for fate points, you get to add a clue at the longest range. So it's the opposite of Susan Rodriguez's skill, because hers is a clue to the closest range. And then her stunt is She can flip it over and get one fate point for every foe that has hits in each case that has clues on it. Fate is super important because the fate points are what fuel your ability to play cards. And for an example here, let's see what Karen's got in her bag of tricks in the seven cards. Can't attack the toad demon. And we only have four fate points, so she could use this to put some clues on Victor is missing right here. That might be. Or she could use, see, we got the four fate and the one die that we have to roll randomly. May not want to do that, and I'll explain that in a second. So let's just say Karen's going to use interrogation. Now, see, and this is kind of the funny thing. You really want to look at the cards and kind of think of what you're doing, because sometimes you'll have special abilities in here that will really, like getting cards, adding cards to your deck is super important. So you may not want to waste that. So the reality is, let's say for an example, she's going to play Kevlar vest, take the advantage. She's going to spend one fate, and she could, the range is 2 plus 1. Well, it's already in the 2. So when taken, the player with Karen would be able to draw a card and distribute 2 card draws among other players. Well, it's 3 players, so the Harry player and the Susan player would get to draw a card to add to their decks. Then this would be taken off, and then other cards just get discarded into there. It's going to move further down, and then it would be back to the Susan Rodriguez player. Just for argument's sake, let's say all those fate points were spent. This is an issue that when we played, the gang kind of had with the Dresden Files cooperative card game, is that strangely enough, it seems as if as you're going around, and if people aren't playing the game and really focused on the game, because if you just approach this game where, I'm going to play cards whenever I have a chance to play cards, then you're not going to be able to win the game. But what'll tend to happen is you kind of get into a rotation where suddenly you're out of fate points, and it's the same person who gets stuck having to burn or discard one of their cards to get fate points. So since we already know one of the advantages is off the board, we would maybe look to try to get some fate points by discarding this, getting 3 plus a die, and then, let's say it just came up blank, which we have an obstacle here that says all blanks are -1, so that would only get us the 2 fate points, just as, like I said, a quick example. That would be discarded. We would put a clue on the closest case because that's her special talent. And then it would move on to Harry's turn. Well then, okay, now Harry's only got 2 fate points. What's Harry going to do? He could pass. Then it moves on to Karen Murphy. Well, now there's only 1 fate point. There's a lot of discarding of cards, and as I mentioned, some of the players, and myself included, I was like, I gotta be honest, when first time we played, I kept looking in the rule book because I thought, there's no way, we can't be playing this game correctly. There's no way. Well, yes way, we were playing it 100% correct. Anyway, moving right along, let's kind of jump towards the end game because that's how you sort of kind of rotate through the game. The game will come to an end when you launch the showdown phase. The showdown phase takes place anytime that a player has no cards and can't pass, Or a player plays a card, like we saw the one had a cost of 2 plus a die. If they play that card and they roll that die and it turns out they had to spend more fate than what's available in the fate point pool. Or the players decide they want to trigger the showdown. And the showdown is this card right here. And what will happen is you're able to roll fate dice against any foe or case that either has hits or clues on them. If you have fate points, it's possible to spend fate in order to get automatic hits or clues, as well as being able to roll dice to determine if you get any more additional clues. Keep in mind, the fate dice, see where it says, okay, so for an example, spending one fate would get one hit and then five dice. It's well within the realm of possibility you could roll five negatives, which would mean you would get no hits. You could roll five positives and get six hits. So there's a very, very wide range of results in the showdown. Keep in mind, you're only allowed to do this with foes that have hits and cases that have clues. It's kind of interesting, this mechanic, but in my opinion, it's also very, very anticlimactic, because you can't tell me you just spent the last 28 minutes playing all these cards, passing, discarding cards, because you're never going to clear all these cards off. We never did. I'm sure somebody out there has lucked out and they got the perfect hands or decks of cards for their characters, and this just lined up perfectly and they were able to do it. We haven't. So really, and it even says in the rules, what you need to do is you need to always have the showdown in mind as you're playing, because you're trying to get the clues on the cards, the hits on the foes, because it'll give you an opportunity to knock the foes off and solve the cases in the showdown phase. Once the showdown's over, as I mentioned, it all boils down to, have you solved more cases than foes remaining on the board? That's it. Once again, I'm going to harp a little bit on the showdown phase. I personally found it very, very anticlimactic. And it just leaves way, way too much in the hands of chance, or I guess we would say fate, on if you're able to win this game or not. Takes about 10 to 15 minutes to learn how to play the Dresden Files. Takes about 30 minutes to play the game as well. So that is what happens when you bring the Dresden Files cooperative card game to the table. Let's move on to my overall thoughts.
By this point, you're no doubt wondering, what are my overall thoughts of the Dresden Files cooperative card game? And you may have pieced together from some of the comments that I made during the gameplay video that I think it's all right as a game, I just don't think it's great. And I think that there's a lot of problems with the overall randomness of the game design. In fact, personally, I think the design's a little undercooked. And the reason behind that, too, is because there's so many different options and variants that are included in the short rulebook. That's usually telling me that the designer wasn't all in on the finished product. It's kind of a puzzle game, so that makes it pretty interesting. And I know a lot of people are going to dig that aspect of it. But as I mentioned, once again, it is very, very possible, because of the randomness of the cards that are drawn to make up the story, the two rows of six cards, that it can be pretty difficult to solve the cases or eliminate the foes, plus the randomness of the cards that you draw in the first place, depending on each of the characters, makes it fairly easy, depending on the number of players, for you to have a character whose specialty is, let's say, investigation, who really doesn't have investigation cards to utilize. That's a bit of a problem as well. Whereas I think it's okay as a puzzle game, I don't really get the whole Dresden Files vibe of the game either. the theme is pretty weak. And it's unusual because there are so many novels to be drawn upon. But on the other hand, it's not unusual to see a licensed product come a little short as far as the theme. This could be about anything. The game could have had each of the players representing an allied POW in a Stalag, and they're trying to escape, and the various cards could have been challenges they had to face to be able to get out of the prisoner of war camp. It could be set in a space station. Nothing really drives home the feeling of Jim Butcher's stories outside some artwork and the titling of the cards. I'll be the first to admit, I am not heavily invested into the Dresden Files novels. But when we were playing four players, my best friend Elliot Miller, who many of you recall from the gaming gang and who now runs his own site, Voice of E, joined us, and he is a huge Jim Butcher fan. He has read every single one of the books, plus other novels that Butcher has written that have nothing to do with the Dresden Files. And he really did not feel like he was playing a Dresden Files game. And he thought it was pretty cool that, for an example, two of Harry Dresden's investigation cards are consulting with Bob, yet, big deal, so it just says consulting with Bob. So Elliot was very, very disappointed with the theme not being thoroughly baked into the game. Myself, I didn't take it that hard, seeing that, like I said before, I'm not necessarily a big fan of Jim Butcher's books. I've only read a couple of them. And they were fine, don't get me wrong. Don't start sending me hate emails. Overall, I think the Dresden Files cooperative card game is fun. Like I said, it's okay. I'd even say it's good as a game, not so great as a representation of the Dresden Files. And I think fans of that book series are going to be split on this game. Some folks are going to be excited because it's just the Dresden Files. It has the name, and it's got the characters, it's got artwork. And then other folks are going to be disappointed because it's just kind of a puzzle game and it's stamped with the Dresden Files. All in all, in the end, I give the Dresden Files cooperative card game a 6.5 out of 10. Once again, I'm Jeff McAleer. Thanks so much for watching. And of course, for the latest in gaming news, reviews, comics, movies, TV, you know the drill by now. Get your geek on at thegaminggang.com. And until next time, take care.